Good afternoon, brothers and sisters.
Good afternoon.
It's so good to see everyone here again on another Sunday. We get to worship together. And as our custom, we start our service with a call to worship. And today's call to worship comes from Psalms 25. My computer closed down on me. And my password is really long. Today's call to worship comes from Psalms 25, verse 1 through 10, and it says, "To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. I trust in you. Do not let me be put to shame, nor let my enemies triumph over me. No one who hopes in you will ever be put to shame, but shame will come on those who are treacherous without cause. Show me your ways, Lord. Teach me your paths. Guide me in your truth and teach me, for you are God, my Savior, and my hope is in you all day long. Remember, Lord, your great mercy and love, for they are from the old. Do not remember the sins of my youth and my rebellious ways," sometimes the sins of my oath, right? but remember me according to your love, for you, O Lord, are good. Good and upright is the Lord. Therefore, he instructs sinners in his ways. He guides the humble in what is right and teaches them his ways. All the ways of the Lord are loving and faithful towards those who keep the demands of his covenant. Let's pray. Dear Lord God, Father, we thank you so much for your loving ways. Father, we sin against you time and time again. Yet every time you forgive us and you show us your ways, Father, because your ways are right and good. Father, just everything about you is good and love. So it would behoove us just to follow you in your ways, Father. And it's not like we have to guess, Father. You show us. You show us the path. You show us the way to rightness and love. That path is Jesus, Father, that we just put our trust in you, Father, and that we try to be like Jesus. So, Father, we ask that you come and you teach us your ways in this service, Father. Move us out of the way so that your light and your glory shines through, Father. Take over this service so that whatever you have for us, whatever it is that you have to teach us today, we will hear it. Help us to open our hearts and minds to absorb it in and know that you are good. And, Father, we ask it all in the name of your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's all stand. And just like it said in the psalm, we're going to sing to God to show me your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths.
I trust you, oh my.
your way.
Because your way is a light and a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. So let's sing that song, Thy Word. You showed it when you gave your life on Calvary, Father. You thought that we were worth saving, Father, that we, these puny humans, your creation, that you came down to be like one of us, and you gave your life, that even though, like we said in those songs, sometimes our heart wanders away from you, and we sin, but Father, you have won it all. You have died so that we can be free from our sins. So let's sing this song, Worth.
So you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping. So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. So you sacrificed your life. So I can be free. So I can be whole. So I can tell everyone I know. You thought I was. So you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping. So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. So you sacrificed your life. So I can be free. So I can be whole. So I can tell everyone I know. You thought I. So you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping. So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. So you sacrificed your life. So I could be free. So I could be whole. So I could tell everyone. So you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping. So you cleaned me up.
So you cleaned me up inside.
You thought I was to die for. You thought I was to die for. You thought I.
Yes, praise his name. Y'all may be seated in the house of the Lord. And before we do the offering, I just want to make an announcement. As some of you may have heard, if you're in our WhatsApp chat, Mr. Raymond Johnson passed away this week. The Johnsons were, like, when we moved here from Miami, from New Jersey down to Miami, the Johnsons were the first family that invited us to their house. I remember many nights sleeping over with Tanya and Mona and my dad and Mr. Johnson talking for hours after services, and we like, can we go home? So this is, and actually it's just starting to hit me now, very hard, but we were given permission by Mrs. Johnson to let you all know that Mr. Raymond Johnson, a faithful soldier, a dedicated elder, and servant man of God, transitioned to be home with the Lord. And although we rejoice that he's with the Lord, we will miss him here. He was a shining example of God's faithful dedication, commitment, and grace. He will be greatly missed, and we lift up the family and remain here for them. They have requested that no flowers but donations be donated to a particular hospice center in Tallahassee. And also the service will be this coming Friday at 11 a.m. in Tallahassee. So we ask that you lift up the Johnsons in prayer, because I know that this is, you know, if it feels like this to me, imagine how much that's their dad, her husband. So please lift them up in prayer. And now we prepare our hearts and minds for the offertory. And our offertory comes from Acts 20, verse 35, which says, remembering the words that Jesus, the Lord Jesus himself, said that it is more blessed than to give than to receive. And here at GCI Miramar, we have three ways to give. We can give here in the back at the offering plate. We can give online at GCI Miramar, or we can give by text at 954-613-2915. And before our message by our brother Robert Mitchell, we'll have a prayer by Mrs. Linda Stroy.
As we go before the throne of our awesome, 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 awesome God. Father God, we come before you this morning just to say thank you for this another day and another opportunity to come together as brothers and sisters to worship you and to hear your word that you have already prepared for us. Father God, we come before you as you tell us to come boldly before the throne of grace, that we will find mercy and grace in time of need. And Father God, right now, we need a little bit of your mercy and your grace. And we thank you, Father God, because we know that when we are with you, that we are never out of your sight. You see us and you see everything that is going on. So Father God, we just pray right now that you would just lift us up, help us to encourage one another and to strengthen one another. Father God, we pray in the name of Jesus, as you boldly speak through your minister, Pastor Taylor, that you, Father God, preach through Mr. Robert, that you would continually to fill him with your mercy, with your love, with your grace, and let the message, Father God, that you have for us, that he will bring it forth with clarity, Father God, with boldness, and Father God, we will come to know and to understand the message that you have for us today. So we thank you, because we know that only by your power, by your might, by your strength, can we do anything that is pleasing to your sight. So we honor you and we glorify you today. And we say thank you again for another day. Thank you, Father God, for just being there for us. Even in our time of need, we can call upon the name of the Lord. And we know that you hear us, you answer us, and you provide everything that we stand in need of, because you and you alone are God Almighty. And Father God, in you we put our trust, and we put our hope, we put our joy, and we put everything that we need into your hands, because whatever we need, you've got it. So we thank you, and we give you all the glory and all the praise in the mighty, awesome name of your Son, our Lord and Savior, who died for us, that we might have this opportunity to call you Abba, Father. In his holy, righteous name we pray. Amen.
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 Help me out here. Huh? I think I got it. Praise God. Thank you for that wonderful prayer, Sister Stoyer. Praise the Lord, church.
Praise the Lord.
Praise God. It's an honor and a privilege to be before you this afternoon. To God be the glory. Great things he has done. He giveth his son that we may have life eternally. And we thank you. I'd like to thank my wife for doing a great job with the driving this morning. And as you see, I got past the fashion police. It's not always an easy thing to do around my house. And speaking of the police, you know, have you ever seen that show where there is some kind of a crime taking place? Somebody commits a crime, and the police see them, or they're called, and they rush right out, and they're in hot pursuit of the criminals. The criminal runs through an alley, sees a fence, and then scales the fence like some kind of a squirrel or something. And then the police officer tries to get over the fence but falls hard on the pavement on the other side. And the crook gets away, but not for long. Because of some nifty police work, it's not long before the SWAT team is assembled outside some dingy hotel room or motel room, and they're there waiting to break down the door. They are armored up, fully armored, but the detective, of course, is wearing no armor. And they bust in the door, they break it down, yelling things like, "Freeze, freeze, police, police, show me your hands, show me your hands." And nobody even bothered to check and see that the door was open, right? You know, in real life, the police do far more knocking on doors than breaking them down. But breaking down the door is a lot more dramatic for the uninvolved observer, the people watching the show. But what does it mean when God breaks down a door? Hallelujah. You know, when God breaks the door down, it also signifies that there's an urgent need, that there's something urgent that has to be handled, that he's not going to let his children escape into sin and shame, that he is going to do whatever it takes to rescue us, to capture us, to cover us. And this is what happened with the baptism of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Our scripture reading today comes from Mark chapter 1, verses 9 through 15. The scripture reads, "And it came to pass in those days that Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized of John in Jordan. And straightway coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens opened, and the Spirit, like a dove, descended upon him. And there came a voice from heaven, saying, 'Thou art my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. And immediately the Spirit driveth him into the wilderness. And he was there in the wilderness 40 days, tempted of Satan, and was with the wild beast. And the angels ministered unto him. Now after that, John was in prison, and Jesus came into Galilee, preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God. The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. Hallelujah. Let us pray. Oh, hallelujah, Father God. We thank you, Heavenly Father. We thank you for this service today. We thank you for your saving grace. We thank you for tearing apart the heavens and descending upon your Holy Son and descending into the world as a spirit, that you may be there for your children to cover us, to take care of all our needs, to signify in a new way, Lord, that we have a close relationship with you, that you are there for us and with us. We thank you, Lord, for this wonderful congregation. We thank you for each and every one present here and those that may hear this message later. Lord, we ask that thou will remove me out of the way this morning. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. The boundaries were torn. As Jesus came up out of the water and that dove descended upon him from heaven, God tore the fabric of space and time, and the edges were frayed. He didn't surgically cut them or carefully separate them. He ripped it open on our behalf, that it may never be mended. You know, when a door is kicked in, that door has to be rehung. That door can be fixed. But when God tore the heavens open and descended into the world for his children, he did it in such a way that would last for all eternity, that tear was a permanent tear that would never be mended until he was ready to mend it. God's passionate pursuit of his children. When Jesus came up out of the water and was driven into the wilderness, he was in the wilderness with the wild beast, and he was spending time with his father to prepare himself for the start of his earthly ministry. He withstood all manner of temptation, where he faced the undergrowth of sin and shame that we would suffer in our lives. And he overcame the overgrowth that poured out on us as his father descended into the world. Christ was led into the wilderness that we may not have to be in the wilderness forever. God wanted to keep his children safe from the schemes of the devil. Oh, that wicked one. But the good news that when Christ came out of the wilderness, that we may draw near to him, that draw near to God, and the kingdom of God was established. God has an overflowing love for humanity. His children, we move closer to him as he moves closer to us. And like a gentle rain, the showers joined in the multitude that we saw the baptism of God, the God, baptism of Jesus, God as man, that moved us closer to him. And he became a vessel. He became a vessel like the divine symphony that poured out the waters onto humanity that blessed us. God is like the orchestra conductor that conducts the divine symphony of his children. We are the instruments, the hands and the feet that God uses here on earth to accomplish the things that he needs done. I heard someone say that nobody's ever seen God make a chair because he needs physical hands to do that. But when I heard that, I thought instantly, well, Jesus was a carpenter. So I don't know if that's exactly right. In a way, God did make a chair, didn't he? Yeah. In that divine symphony, he weaves melodies within melodies. Hallelujah. And the master composer of divine salvation. In the wilderness, when Christ was working his way through the thick undergrowths covering us from the overgrowths that would try and take over our lives with sin and temptation. In a small village, nestled among the trees that guarded them from the outside world. The villagers also yearned for freedom, and they wanted to break through and break out of that confine. And isn't that the way it is? Sometimes we set up these barriers to protect us from the outside world. And then it seems at times the same barriers that we set up to keep others out and to protect us from the outside are those same barriers that has us trapped on the inside. And those are the devices, you know, that we set up for ourselves, often confined by our own doing. There was a young lady named Sarah who was trying her best to break through from her circumstances. In the village that Sarah lived in, there were thick trees and thick overgrowths, but Sarah one day found a door. An old weather door. And the door seemed locked and impenetrable, and no matter how she looked, where she looked, she could not find a key to get through this door. She asked the other villagers for their assistance, And they just ignored her because to them, this locked door just wasn't worth their time. Now, Samuel was behind a closed door. The barriers in his life and limitations, but Samuel prayed. Samuel prayed to God and asked him for a way to get through this door. There was a young lady named Lydia in another village. Lydia was having difficulty in her career and her life path. She had hit that glass ceiling, that formidable glass ceiling. Y'all know what I'm talking about, that glass ceiling? That is often set in place to keep marginalized individuals out of certain opportunities, whether it's by their gender or their race, or for whatever have you reason, the gatekeepers just keep them out. Like, these opportunities are just for us, and everybody else needs to stay down there. Well, one day Lydia was laying in the grass, just taking a break from her labor, and as she looked up, her eyes were fixed on the majestic eagle soaring in the sky. And as she looked up at the majestic eagle, the eagle was soaring around, looking through the thick loops of branches where its nest was. The nest of the eagle represents a place of safety, a place of comfort, and a place of resoluteness. Now, God symbolizes the eagle, the watchful, divine nature of the Father, looking over his children. That eagle fearlessly breaks through that glass ceiling. That eagle fearlessly breaks through and creates opportunities there where there were none before. The symphony of redemption that is played by the divine orchestra created by God as he uses his children in certain ways brings us into divine harmony. Each instrument that's being played serves a different purpose. It's like members of the body. The hands don't do what the feet do, and the head doesn't do what the chest does and the knees do. Those instruments, the drums are playing boom, 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 boom over here, and the strings are playing ding, ding, ding over here. But somehow when it all comes together, it creates a divine harmony that brings about the purpose that God created us for. One day, Samuel cried out to God, and he heard a voice from God saying, in order to break through that door, you must have faith. Faith is the key. Even with just the faith of a mustard seed. And Samuel thought long and hard on it and became empowered and encouraged, because in the past, no matter how he pushed and no matter how he kicked, he could not get through that door. But now, being given that key of faith, faith in God, faith in himself, Samuel pushed through that door, and when he broke through that door, the room was flooded by a divine light from above, Samuel had broken through that door, the obstacles in his life. And when he boldly walked through that doorway, on the other side, he found work that he was passionate about, and he found Sarah, the woman of his dreams. They had beautiful children and a ministry. They served, winning many souls for Christ. The good news is that when God tore open the heavens and descended into the world as a spirit to be with his children, he never repaired that breach. God's passionate presence should fill us and fill our hearts with joy. This is the gospel by which we should live. Ladies and gentlemen, do you know what time it is? Do we really know what time it is? When you set your alarm clock, or you set the clock on the phone, you may think you know what time it is, but if you look around and see what's going on in the world today, we have to know that the time is near. All the signs are there. Draw close to God as he draws close to you. These are my few humble words today. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for this opportunity. We thank you for our leadership. We thank you for being God all by yourself. We thank you for sitting high and looking low. We thank you, Lord, for tearing the heavens open and descending into the world that we may have a closer walk with you. We thank you for sending your Son into the world in the form of man to be a shining example to us. We thank you for the example that he set. For if even Jesus, the Christ, felt a need for baptism, a need for redemption, then what of us, Lord? What is man that God should be mindful of him? We thank you, Lord. We bless you, Lord. And we ask in your holy and righteous name that what was said here today and what was done here today will somehow find a way into the hearts and minds of your children. That as you continue to play your divine symphony, that you use us as your instruments, Lord, that you weave the melodies together, that you play the harmonies and syncopated instruments as we move through this life to keep us marching to the drum that you want us marching to. Until that time, as thou shalt. Enter back into the world in a way that brings us home. We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 Brothers and sisters, if we can stand, we can sing our last song. You know, one thing when God tore open the heavens, and it's like Brother Mitchell said, I'm wishing into existence. God left that open, and that's something for us to have joy for, right? So let's sing this song, because there's joy in the house of the Lord, amen? Because we are free, we are saved, and our God has forgiven all of our sins, and we have direct access to him, amen?
Worship the God who is. We worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison door. He parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory. Yeah. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Oh, 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 we shout out your praise.
Can I get a little bit more on the music?
We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. Cause he hung up on that cross, and he rose up from that grave. My God's still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet.
Holy Spirit be with you all, and all God's people said, amen. God bless you all. We'll see you here next week, same time, same place. Thank you.